Hello. Trying the music again. So the next two, this experience and the one right after it, so experience two and three for this module, they kind of go together. So I broke them into two, but thematically they work together. Now in the last video, I tied together ancient DNA research with the archaeological record in Europe from about 50,000 years ago to about 14,000 years ago. The genetics that was part of that presentation was primarily pulled from a paper that was published in 2016 that analyzed 51 ancient genomes from across Europe and Western Asia. So for this video and the four that follow, we're going to be pulling in evidence results, analytical results from two ancient DNA studies they're both from the same research group that's led by David Reich at Harvard. One is from 2014 and the other one is from 2019. And I intertwine this with the archaeological evidence and then some other pieces of information as well. What I want to do first off, though, is to do a recap and to set that into perspective with the advent of farming. So we've looked at human population history in Eurasia from about 50,000 to 39,000 years ago first, and we saw those basal Eurasians, this population that stems from northeastern Africa about 50,000 years ago. We saw that they, from that population, derived the earliest hunter-gatherers. These are people that coexisted with, to some degree, with the Neanderthals. We also learned that the basal Eurasians were the source population for another ghost population that we will be talking about more later in this module called the Ancient North Eurasians, but you're going to see them make little appearances in the videos that are part of this set for this experience and the one right after. We learned about that volcano, the 39,000 years ago supervolcanic eruption, which then basically appears to have wiped out the human cultures, the cultural groups that were living in this area of the world at the time, and that then were replaced by different cultural groups. This accords with the genetic evidence, because we see evidence of another population deriving out of that basal Eurasian, that ghost basal Eurasian population, moving into Europe after the volcanic eruption. So from 37,000 years ago to 14,000 years ago, the populations living in Europe, they pretty much all descended from this one ancestral population that derived out of that basal, the basal Eurasians. So we have then the Gravettian expansion from 33,000 to 22,000 years ago. They came in and they replaced the Aurignacians, which were the ones we were just talking about. And of course, don't forget, we've got those ancient North Eurasians. So there were people living elsewhere in the world at the time. And then once we get to about 22,000 years ago, you have the last glacial maximum. And we talked about how much of a dramatic effect this had on global climate, and that it basically put a lot of these human cultural groups, these different human populations, into extreme duress. We see a lot of these cultural groups receding out of their distribution, geographic distribution before that, moving into what we call refugia, many of those being in more southern latitudes. So then the ice starts to recede very gradually from 19,000 to 14,000 years ago in the second part of the last glacial maximum. And as that ice starts to recede, we see the Magdalenian expansion that coincides with the extinction of the mammoths occurring in peninsular Europe. Don't forget, there were people there as well. So we can think then of people around this large geographic region as sort of clouds, these clusters of people and populations. And this is what the genetic architecture is showing us, that you have these five major groups that we can envision in our minds. And I want to point out that they tend to correspond, the breaks between them tend to correspond with these really major river systems. So the Tigris and Euphrates, Indus River, Volga. Now, for those of you who have grown up around major river systems, you have a sense of just how important rivers are, especially to, as you can imagine, to groups prior to cars, to airplanes. These were major forces shaping the way that people interacted with the geography and the landscape. Another way, thing that really influences the way people interact with their geography and landscape is, of course, climate. And we've seen this figure before, thinking about climate change and the really being driven by the temperature change in, of the globe. So we have that last glacial maximum at about 22,000 years ago. It stays pretty cold. There's some ups and downs as you're getting into about 18,000 years ago. And once we get to about 14,000 years ago, you have this warming spell caused by changes and shifts in ocean circulation, the Bolling-Alerod global warming. But then the Earth falls into another, especially in Europe, falls into this second pretty short cold spell called the Younger Dryas. And then you start getting into the Holocene warming that we are in today. So I want to draw your attention to that warming period after the Younger Dryas, because this is when there's some really important things happening in terms of human innovation. And it's happening on a global scale, not just in certain parts or just one part of the world, but globally, as the climate started to warm around the world, around Earth, some innovation really started happening. And that innovation is domestication. Let's look first at animal domestication. You can see on this map just a really broad overview of when animals were domesticated, plants included on that too. We'll take a look at them in just a second. But dogs were the first animals that appear to have been domesticated by humans. Started about 15,000 years ago is the earliest evidence, and it happened more than once. We see it in multiple populations, multiple major geographic regions, so not just in one place. So simultaneously, people were figuring out that dogs could be useful companions in hunting, especially. We have evidence of sheep being domesticated about 10,000 years ago, pigs 8,000 years ago, cattle about 8,000 years ago. This appears to have happened more than once. Horses were domesticated about 6,000 years ago, happened more than once. Llamas 4,500 years ago in South America. We have a lot of innovation, human innovation, going on around the world. And I just want to point out that these ages, I've rounded them, so they're very rough ages. So if you dive into the archaeological literature, you'll find that there's these are not the specific dates. But just to give you a rough sense of what was happening, where and when. Let's look at some plants as well. So agriculture started around the same time in four different parts for major geographic regions of the world. So in Mesoamerica, we see evidence of the domestication of maize, of corn, which is this wild grass called teosinte that was just dramatically altered over the course of that domestication process to form the corn that we're familiar with now. But it comes from a grass that looks really different than corn. We also have rice was domesticated, being in the Yangtze region of Southeast Asia. You have in the lowland and the highland regions of South America, you have potato, peanut, and manioc. And then in the Fertile Crescent, so down where the Tigris and Euphrates rivers are, so that's the valleys of Tigris and Euphrates and Jordan rivers and the adjacent hills in that area, you have the domestication of wheat, barley, lentil, and chickpeas. So in multiple regions around the world, as you get into that warmer and warmer period, people were innovating, figuring out what they could do with the plants and animals around them and taking charge of them and controlling what they look like, controlling their reproduction. Dramatic innovation that just basically changes everything. And we're going to see this time and time again over the rest of this semester, how massive the influence of domestication, plant and animal domestication, has been on human evolution and human variation. So the global impact of domestication is something that I'd like for you to investigate a bit on your own. We have assigned you a reading for this intellectual experience. And in that reading, you're going to find out about how nearly half, 42% of the regions occupied by humans had some form of agriculture by 6,000 years ago. So it caught on like wildfire, which is probably not the best analogy right now, given that we are having a lot of wildfires it's very smoky. And heart goes out to all those people really much, much closer to the fires. But agriculture really caught on and spread very, very quickly. And by 3,000 years ago, to evidence this, most of the planet was already transformed by hunter-gatherers, farmers, and pastoralists. So you'll get to explore that much more in the reading that I've assigned for you. So enjoy that. Now I want to spend a little bit of time in this video to think about how agriculture actually arose, because it didn't just happen overnight. It's a really slow incremental process that played out over thousands of years. And I want to give you an example to give you a sense of how that happened. So we're going to go back to about 23,000 years ago to Ohalo, which is there's a number of archaeology sites. So we're going to go to this one archaeology site on the shore of the Sea of Galilee in Israel. It's a fisher, a hunter-gatherer campsite, and it has evidence of small-scale cultivation of wheat. So we're going over into this region of the world. So how do we know that a plant is domesticated? So now looking at the earliest evidence that we have is that 23,000 years ago site, but now I want to show you the morphological evidence. We have that earliest evidence with the fishing and hunting and gathering about 23,000 years ago, and now over 10,000 years or 12,000 years, that was a very gradual process, and now we're going to see that play out gradually as well over the next 4,000 years. So we're going to go from 10,000 years to about 6,000 years, 6,500 years, and look at wheat. So this one particular type of plant that was domesticated over that time period in the Fertile Crescent. So here is some photographs of wheat, and on the right hand side by the letter A, you have the wild type of wheat. And what happens is that as the spikelet comes into maturity, as it ripens and gets into maturity, that it breaks off, and it's been adapted over many millions of years to break off really cleanly and disperse, because remember, this is the seed for the grass. And in the panel C, you can see a photograph where you have this really smooth scar from where that spikelet has broken off from the stem and been dispersed by the wind. Now on the left-hand side by the letter D, you have the domesticated version. And over time, people selected for and kept replanting the seeds of the wheat stalks that didn't break off that easily. So it was a lot harder. If it was a lot harder for the little seed to break off, then people, it would mature, it would stay stuck to the stalk, and then people could break it off when they were threshing the wheat. And this is where threshing becomes necessary, because the little spikes are not falling off, breaking off as they would in the wild version of this. So instead of falling off and breaking off on their own and leaving that smooth scar, as you see in the photograph with C, it actually has to be broken off, and so you have this much rougher, fragmented fracture as it's threshed off of the stalk, and you see that picture in E. So we can see these in the archaeological record. You see the wheat that has the really smooth scars where it just breaks off easily and floats away in the wind, and then you have that The scarred one, where it's much more rough of a fracture, where it needed to be threshed off by human activity. So what you see over here on the right-hand side of your screen is these bar graphs that show the proportionality of the wheat that were recovered from these archaeological sites and the proportionality of ones that are that wild version where it just breaks off really easily, and the domestic version, the evidence of domesticated ones, where they had to be broken off with force through threshing. And at 10,000 years ago, the vast majority, about 70 to 80% of the wheat that they're finding, is that wild version. Some of it seems to be possibly domestic. And then as you move forward through time, so from 10,200 years ago on the left of that figure, moving through time, you get to 7,000 years ago and 6,500 years ago, and you see an increase in that domestic morphology and just a very little proportion of that wild morphology. Remember, thinking about the morphology of how the spikelet breaks off from the stalk. Is it smooth, which is the wild version, or is it very rough, and that's the domesticated version? And so this is how archaeologists have figured out when you start to see the very beginnings of wheat domestication, and all the way to when basically most all of the wheat that's present is this domesticated morphology. 4,000 years. This didn't happen overnight. It's a very gradual process. Much like evolution by natural selection, a small gradual process where it's small from generation to generation, you're just gradually changing the frequency of a morphology, the frequency of a gene, of an allele that would lead to this kind of different morphology, this different breakage of how the spikelets come off of the stalks. But in this instance, it isn't natural selection, it's human selection. That is domestication. So with that, we'll take a little break, and I will see you on the other side, the next video.